Glory to God. It's such a privilege to be here to share with us the word of the Lord. I want to appreciate the convener, Mrs. Emran Basham, for the honor to be here to share with God's people. I'm particularly delighted about the B Project, and I'm sure that in this June series, the Intimacy series, God is going to be doing us great good, and a lot of us will be brought into realms and dimensions in God that we've not operated in before, and that will strengthen our walk with God and make us more effective ambassadors of the kingdom in this side of the divide. Today is the first class on our Intimacy series, and we are going to be dealing with how to hunger for God, or how to hunger for the presence. And this is a very important subject, particularly because if you study the blueprint of creation, you are going to realize that everything God had in mind, the possibility of expression of everything God has in mind, is only obtainable within the ambience of God's presence. So it's important for us to understand not just the presence of God, but how to hunger and perpetually stay in sync with the presence of God, because that's the only way our lives will count, not only in time but also in eternity. I'd like to quickly explain what the presence of God is, because it's possible for somebody to mistake the presence of God to something very mundane, something very earthly, something very sensual. What do I mean by that? A lot of people think because they are crying, they are in the presence of God. A lot of people think because their eyes are closed and they are quiet, they are in the presence of God. I need to explain a few things very quickly for us to understand. So I'll begin this morning by explaining what the presence of God is, and then I'll explain what it means to live in the presence of God. Afterwards, I will also talk about how to hunger for the presence of God, because if I just start talking about hunger for the presence of God, you may not know what the presence of God is, you may not know how to operate in the presence of God, and it may be very difficult for you to make meaning out of what we're talking about. So let me begin quickly by explaining what the presence of God is. It's important for us to understand that there's a difference between being in the spirit and being in the presence. Being in the spirit is simply a function of the indwelling spirit of God within a man's heart. In Romans chapter 8 verse 9, Paul said, "You are not in the flesh, but you are in the spirit, if so be that the spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the spirit of God, he is none of Christ." So what it means to be in the Spirit is for the Holy Ghost to dwell in you, or to be of Christ, to be born again. So if you have the Holy Spirit, according to Romans 8 verse 9, you are in the Spirit. So it's possible for somebody to be in the Spirit and lie. It's possible for somebody to be in the Spirit and fornicate. It's possible for somebody to be in the Spirit and walk in and carry out all the sensualities of life. So that's what Paul meant when he said, you are in the Spirit if you have the Holy Ghost in you. And that's why most times, in the midst of sin, God can speak to a man. In the midst of sin, God can invade a man's space. The reason is because the man has the Spirit of God. In fact, the church in Corinth were living in fornication, and Paul would tell them, "Do you not know that the Holy Ghost dwells in your bodies? That your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit?" So they were actually in the Spirit while they were yet sinning. So being in the Spirit is not the same as being in the presence. You know, being in the Spirit is what is generically referred to as the presence of God, the omnipresence of God. God is everywhere, and everywhere the Spirit of God is, God is. That's what it means. But when we are talking about the presence of God, as we'll be dealing with in this context, is the manifest presence of God. What does it mean to be in the presence of God? To be in the presence of God refers to a few things that I will mention. I'll just mention three of them as they would help us to navigate in this class. You are in the presence of God when the influence of God's life and essence rules and regulates you. You are in the presence of God when the influence of God's life rules and regulates you. So you don't just have the Holy Spirit in you, but the power of the Spirit, the life, the essence of God's spirit, the will of God, the mind of God, the counsel of God controls and regulates your life. If that happens to you, then you know you are in the presence. That's why I said the presence of God is not only crying. That's a measure of it, because sometimes when you are overwhelmed, you can find yourself crying. But it does not stop there. It translates and transcends just weeping or having a feeling. It's actually the establishment of the rulership of God's essence upon a man's life. So when a man is under the government of God perpetually, that man walks from the realm of God's presence. Let me explain. Revelations chapter 21 verse 3. The Bible explains what it means. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. That means these people live perpetually under the ambience and the control of God, and they are God's people. What does that mean? They are not just carriers of God's image, but they are expressing present hour reality, the likeness of God. So God is their God. That means God is their source. God is their sustainer. God is their all. The totality of their reality is captured within the reality of God. That's what it means to be in the presence. And you need to understand that this is possible because the presence of God is majestic. In 1 Chronicles chapter 16 verse 27, the Bible speaks of the majesty that comes with the presence of God. And if the presence of God is majestic, then the presence of God will bring rulership upon the man under whom is in the presence. So 1 Chronicles 16 verse 27, the Bible says, glory and honor are in his presence, strength and gladness are in his place. So God is majestic, and if he shows up, the glory of God is the essence of God. The majesty of God is the splendor of his realm. He said glory and majesty are in his presence. So when he shows up, he will transmit that glory upon a man, and that man becomes an expression of that glory, that essence, that nature, that reality. So the presence of God confers the dominion of God upon a man. In Psalm 97 verse 5, the Bible reiterates the same emphasis. The hills melted like wax at the presence of the Lord, and the presence of the Lord shook the whole earth. That means when the presence of God comes, because of the power, because of the energy level from whence the presence shows, every other thing is compelled to conform to the presence of God. So a man who lives by the flesh, a man who lives lawlessly, is not under the presence of God. No matter what he feels, you cannot define the presence of God by your feeling. You define it by your submission to the government and the rulership of the reality that flows from the realm of God. Secondly, what the presence of God comes to do is that the presence of God comes to re-engineer you from within. When the presence of God shows up, it re-engineers a man from within so that the man can take upon himself the image and the likeness of God, the image of God. The man becomes like unto the living God. In 2 Corinthians 3 verse 18, the Bible says, we all with unveiled faces, beholding as in a glass the image of the Lord, we are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of God. So the presence of God re-engineers a man to sustain the image of God. So when a man bears the image of God, it simply means the man operates by the presence of God. So a man who is not like unto the Lord cannot say he lives under the ambience of the presence. The Bible said in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 48 and 49, he said, because we have borne the earthly, we must also bear the heavenly. He said, as is the earthly, such are they that are earthly. And as is the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly. He said, therefore, as we have borne the image of the earthly, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. What is he saying? The same way we bore the image of Adam, we must bear the image of Christ. So a man who bears the image of God is a man that walks under the presence. And you must understand that he was speaking to the believers. So Paul was talking to born-again Christians. He was not talking to unbelievers. They are born again. Of course, they have the image of God, but they cannot express that image. So Paul was referring to the ability to give expression to the image of God. And the only way that is possible is for we all who have the image of God, unveiled faces, beholding as in a glass the image of the Lord. So the presence of God is where God is beheld. And when God is beheld, man is re-engineered. The third thing we need to know about the presence of God is that the presence of God is that atmosphere where the Holy Ghost walks. The Holy Ghost walks in the presence. That's why in 2 Corinthians 3:18, where we just read, it said we are changed into that image from glory to glory by the Spirit of God. So when the Spirit of God is not walking, it means we are not in the presence of God. In Genesis chapter 1, from verse 1 to 3, the Bible said, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the earth. And God said, so God begins to walk when the presence of God saturates the environment. So you need to understand that the presence of God is that environment where God walks. And every believer must come to that point where God can walk and the Spirit of God has liberty of expression. In Psalm 16, verse 11, the Bible said, in the presence of God there is fullness of joy, and in thy right hand pleasures forevermore. So the presence of God is that environment where we have every liberty, the Holy Ghost has every liberty of bringing us the bounties of God, be it life, be it fullness, be it joy. So if a believer does not have the bounties that comes from that realm, it's because the Holy Ghost is not at work. Because there's one work the Holy Ghost knows to do, is to bring us into the reality of God. In John chapter 16, verse 13, he said, I have many things to show you, but you cannot receive it. How be it when the Spirit of truth is come, he will guide you into all realities. So the Holy Spirit brings us into all reality. That's the work the Holy Ghost does. So when he says in the presence of God there is fullness of joy, he knows what he's saying. The Holy Ghost brings us into the fullness of the measures of God, the realities that are in the realm of God. So the presence of God is not a feeling. The presence of God is a place where the government and the dominion of God rules. The presence of God is a place where man is transformed into the likeness of God. The presence of God is where the Holy Spirit has all the liberty to express the will, the counsel, the wisdom, the mandate of the Father. So every time you see a man living as an expression of the divine, know that you have come under the ambience of God's presence, and that man dwells in God's presence. The Bible said in Hebrews chapter 1, from verse 1 to 3, it said, God, who has sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophet, has in this last day spoken unto us by his Son, who being the brightness of his glory, the express image of his person, upholding all things by the word of his power. So that leads us to the fourth definition of the presence of God. The presence of God is where the dominion mandate is expressed. He said, upholding all things by the word of his power. The dominion mandate can only be expressed where the presence of God is. That's why heaven is a place of perfect order. There can be no disorderliness in heaven. When Lucifer attempted it, he was ejected, because the presence of God is a realm where the dominion of God is expressed. In the Garden of Eden, which is the ambience of God's presence, there was perfect order. The moment the man violated that order and brought rebellion into that system, he was ejected. The presence of God is a ground for the expression of the dominion mandate. So you have no calling except you can walk under the presence. You have no purpose unless you can walk under the presence. You may know that you are a prophet from your childhood, but you will grow into an old man without manifesting the prophetic. You may know that you are an apostle, you may know that you are a governor, you may know that you are a leader, but if that is going to be consistent with the will of God, then it must only find expression under the presence, because it is under the presence that the dominion mandate can be expressed. There is no dominion mandate without the presence of God. So four things we have said very quickly because of our time allowance is that the presence of God is where the government of God rules a man. Second, the presence of God is where man is brought to a place where he can bear the image of God, the heavenly. Thirdly, the presence of God is where the Holy Ghost is allowed uncheckered access of expression. And what the Holy Ghost does, like we said, is to bring us into the fullness of God. And finally, the presence of God is where the dominion mandate can find expression. Check your life very quickly. Is these four things, or are these four things at work? If they are, then know that you are carrying the presence of God. Now, it's important for us to also understand something very quickly, that The Holy Ghost dwelling in man can come cheaply. And what I mean by that is, it comes based on the finished works of Christ. You did nothing. But living in the presence comes with a great price. You can accept Jesus, believe in your heart upon receiving the gospel and confess Jesus as Lord and receive the Holy Spirit. The Bible said in Romans chapter 10 verse 9 and 10, it said that if we believe in our heart the Lord Jesus and confess with our mouth, we shall be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So the Holy Ghost came to tabernacle in us, bringing us salvation when we believed in our heart the Lord Jesus and we confessed with our mouth. So that's cheap, because we didn't pay the price for that to happen. Jesus paid the price. It wasn't easy, but it was given to us freely on account of God's love. So on account of God's love and our faith in Jesus, we can receive the Holy Spirit, right? But when it comes to dealing with the presence, it's going to come with a great price. And it comes with a great price because the presence of God is guarded by certain spiritual infrastructures that God can never compromise. God can never compromise on all of that. And I want to show us these seven infrastructures very quickly that we must pay the price to walk through in order to become agent of the presence, carriers of the presence. You need to understand something very quickly as you do the business of the presence. Spirits are not mortals. Spirits do not live in the realm of space and time, so to say, chronological time. Spirits live in the realm of life and are operated by light, or the realm of death and are operated by darkness. Now, what that means is that if I step out of a room, I leave that room behind. So I cannot carry my environment. But because spirit is not regulated by space and chronological time, but regulated by life and light, or darkness and death, spirits can carry their environment. So if a spirit enters a place, he comes with his environment. Now, if he leaves that place, he lives with his environment. He can leave a deposit of his environment, but he carries his environment along with him. That's how they operate. Therefore, it's needful for us to understand that time is a region where the fragmentation of spirits exist as moments. So they are particles of these fragmentations. This is what we call the Kairos moment. So the chronological time is not reality. The chronological time is actually a preparatory time for that moment where the essence and the life of spirit that are fragmented into this realm can be contacted. So time is actually a chronological fragmentation of life and light, or of death and darkness. So a man's life has no value except as he can tap into the economy of life and operate it by the degree of light that he has. If a man cannot tap into that frequency, he is just living like an animal. The Bible said, a man in honor that knoweth not is like the beast of the field that perishes. So the value of a man's life has nothing to do with this mundane realm. This is what we are not taught, and then we fall to the depravity of the fall. What do I mean by that? The fall brought poverty to our soul. Poverty in that we were separated from the realm of God, where we had access to his essence, his life, and then we functioned by his light. Remember, Adam did not have desire for anything. Everything Adam needed was available, because Adam was operating in the fullness of the life of God. And Adam operated by the economy of light. So in Genesis chapter 2 verse 19, the Bible said, the name that Adam called the animals, that was the name there was. Secondly, when God created the woman, Adam was asleep. Adam was asleep. But when Adam woke up, God called the woman, woman, and Adam said, she shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. What does that mean? Adam was functioning by the economy of light. That's the same economy that regulates the realm of God. So Adam functioned by the economy of light, and Adam lived in the abundance of life. So the life of Adam had nothing to do with the mundane. Adam only lived to regulate, to rule over the mundane. So the mundane was to be brought under the government of the life and the light that Adam operated by. So the quality of Adam's life had nothing to do with the fruits, had nothing to do with the animals, had nothing to do with the pleasures of the garden. The quality of Adam's life was the life to which he was plugged and the light from whence he operated. Now, Adam did not realize this, and he trivialized it, and he violated the government of that realm. The moment he violated the government of that realm, he was ejected from that life and ejected from the economy of that light. So Adam fell and declined. Instantly, Adam that was clothed with the glory of God would take fig leaves to cover himself, and God would come and kill an animal and cover Adam. Fig leaves, how often will you have to change it? Because you put it in the morning, in the evening, it's dried off. So it shows you how Adam's mind had deteriorated, because he was no longer functioning by the economy of light. He instantly began to function by the economy of darkness. Adam fell from the realm of life and began to operate from the realm of death. This is the depravity that the soul of man came under on account of the fall. So man now judges his value by what he has. Today you see people, they value themselves by their cars. They value themselves by their bank account. They value themselves by where they work. They value themselves by where they school. It's a statement of the poverty of the soul, because man no longer has access to life and light. So he depends on earthly mundane things to define his value. It's a sign that we are poor. It's a sign that the scarcity of God is the reality that we function by. We function by death and darkness. This is why we operate like that. So the moment we are restored into the economy of life and light, we discover that everything we have becomes a tool for advancing the kingdom. Everything we have becomes a tool of advancing the presence. Everything we have becomes a tool of advancing the will and the counsel of God, so that everything around us will come under the government of God. That means the presence of God becomes the operating system of everything around us. This is what life is about. Like I began to explain, in Jude chapter 1 verse 6, the Bible spoke about the angels that did not keep their first estate were put in chains, unending chains, and they were tied in darkness. So there is outer darkness, and there is darkness, then there is the earth. And then going in the direction of the realm of light, there is heaven, which is eternity, and then there is light that no man can approach. In Genesis chapter 1 verse 1, the Bible said, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And then in 1 Timothy chapter 6 verse 16, the Bible said, God has immortality in him, dwelling in light that cannot be approached. That means from the realm of life, the farthest dimension is light that cannot be approached. From the realm of death, the farthest dimension is outer darkness. Now, because spirits walk not by the economy of space, the realm of light, the realm of light unapproachable, is the environment of God. Now, when God wants his creation to touch him, to know him, and to feel him, remember the Bible said no being can approach that realm. So what God does is that he transmits his life and his light into eternity, into heaven. So the angels can interact with that celestial dimension of God. They can touch the life of God. They can touch the light of God. But God, the totality of God, is not dwelling in eternity. The totality of God dwells in the realm of light that cannot be approached. However, a measure of his light in a concentrated fashion is in eternity. So eternity is actually a region of concentrated life and light. That's why time becomes inconsequential. That's why time is no longer noticed. Because what's happening is that the concentration of God in that realm becomes so thick that you lose the consciousness of time. Remember, when Moses climbed Mount Sinai and God brought that technology of eternity, Moses was there for 40 days and he was not hungry. So the realm of higher concentration came upon Moses. Higher concentration of life, higher concentration of light came upon Moses. And Moses began to navigate into the beginning and into the end.
It was Moses that said, in the beginning, God made heaven and earth. So Moses went ahead of time, and Moses also went to the end, because Moses was the one that said that at the end, God will descend from Mount Paran with 10,000 of his saints. That's the Armageddon battle. So Moses traveled from the beginning of time to the end of time, just in a moment. Why? The concentration of God's life and light came upon him, and he began to live by the economy of eternity. That's the realm that the angelic dwell in. They dwell in a realm of high concentration of God, so much so that the whole time is swallowed up in it. But when you come to earth, God's life and light is fragmented because the concentration is not high. So every creature in time must strive to tap into that concentration of life and light and walk by it, because it is in parchment, it's in fragmentation. The same thing happens in the realm of death. The Bible said God will cast the rebellious into outer darkness and there will be gnashing of teeth. What does that mean? It's a realm where you cannot touch any dimension of God at all. There's no mercy, there's no kindness, there's no love, there's no favor. It is only the operation of death and darkness that is there. And that's where the most wicked of demonic beings and the devils dwell, because it is their reality that emits from there. So anybody that finds himself there will be saturated with wickedness, will be saturated with pain, will be saturated with peril. That's why God said there will be gnashing of teeth. As you move into darkness, you will realize that the concentration will reduce. So man can carry out wickedness where sorcerers live, where witches live. They can perpetrate wickedness because they are interacting with darkness, they are interacting with death. Now the earth becomes the battleground. So the quality of a man's life is actually the degree to which he interacts with death, or the degree to which he interacts with light, with darkness, and then brings it into the earth, or the degree to which he interacts with life or light. So our ability to lay hold on life and to walk by the economy of light is the business of the present. I'm taking time to say this because many would say they are born again. And because they are born again, they are in the presence of God, they don't need anything. That's a lie. That is a lie. I told us already from the beginning, you are in the Spirit if you have the Holy Ghost. No arguments about it. But you are in the presence of God when you are ruled by His government. You are in the presence of God when the Holy Ghost is at work, can have the liberty to walk in your life. You are in the presence of God when you are constantly being re-engineered into the likeness of God. And then you are in the presence of God when you have access to the bounties of God's Spirit, when you can access it. And this is a statement of how much life and light you have at your disposal, because you can be born again and walk by the economy of death and darkness. Yes, you can walk by the economy of death and darkness, and many are walking by that economy. This is what it means to be a fallen man. So a man can be born again yet live by the economy of the fall, which is death and darkness. So we need to take the business of the presence very seriously. And I'm taking it calm today because it's an introductory class. In our next class, I may touch deeper things, and then I may be a bit spontaneous, much more spontaneous than this too, you know, and all of that. But let's just take it gradually so that we can establish the coordinates. Now, how do you walk perpetually in the presence? You walk perpetually in the presence when you allow, you yield to the Holy Spirit at work in you, and He brings the government of the presence to you, and you live by that government. Remember, Adam was created according to Genesis chapter 1 verse 26 in the image and the likeness of God. Number 2, Adam was blessed and granted the ability to have dominion. Meanwhile, dominion is not multiplication, because God said multiply, replenish the earth, subdue it, have dominion. It's not multiplication. Multiplication is actually a channel of dominion. Dominion is actually your ability to bring your creation, your sphere, under the government of the Spirit, so that your realm can operate by the dictates of the Spirit, and your realm becomes a prototype of the realm where you come from. Earth becoming heaven. That's the idea of dominion. It is earth submitting to the government of God so that earth becomes the heavens of God. That's what dominion is. So Adam was created in the image and likeness of God. Adam was blessed and given the empowerment for dominion. But Adam's ability to stay in the presence was not just the function of the image and likeness of God. It was not just the function of the ability of God that was in him. It was Adam's continuous compliance to the government of God that determines his access to the presence. So God said to Abraham, of all the trees that is in the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat, for in the day that thou shalt eat it, thou shalt surely die. And Adam took it for granted and allowed the deception of the serpent. And Adam was deceived of the serpent in Genesis 3 from verse 1 to 5. He ate of the fruit. And God showed up amazingly in Genesis chapter 3 verse 8. And the Bible said the voice of God came walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And naturally when God comes, he synchronizes with Adam. Now God showed up and God said, Adam, where art thou? Adam was still in the garden. But Adam could no longer walk in the realm of God's presence. Adam could no longer access the light of God. Adam could no longer access the abilities of God. He was still in the place, but he had lost contact with God. So God came looking for him. God could no longer sense his vibration, his energy level. And Adam said, I heard your voice in the garden, so I hid myself. And God said, why have you violated government? And Adam would go ahead and say, yes, the woman you gave me, and all of the stories. So what happened is that instantly he was chased out of the presence of God. So what gives you access and right to the presence is not that you are born again. What gives you right to the presence is not that you have the power for dominion. It is your degree of staying under the government of God that keeps you in the presence. This is why the presence is not just I am in the spirit. This is why the presence is not just I am born again. The presence is definitely a governmental reality, and many don't walk there. That's why you see two believers with different experiences. One believer speaks and calls the name of Jesus and a demon checks out. Another believer labors there for 4 hours and the demon is laughing. And in some cases the demon even slaps it. Is it because the devil is strong? No. That's a believer that is under the government of the presence. A believer under the government of the presence can easily check out the demon. But a believer who does not function by the government of the presence, but the government of self or the government of the devil, has no power over the devil. Because when a strong man keeps his house, it takes a stronger man than him to come in, to bind him, and to divide the spoil. So you are not functioning by the economy of God's government. How do you overthrow the government of the devil? I am a Nigerian. I cannot just go to America and say, because I'm a Nigerian, I'm representing Nigeria. No. There's a specific stipulation. Only the ambassador of Nigeria to the U.S. can carry out legislative operation in the U.S. The reason is not because he is a better Nigeria or more a Nigerian than myself. No. The thing is that he is functioning by delegated authority. He is within the ambit of the government of Nigeria. So it is the government of Nigeria that appoints him, and it's not even enough that he's appointed. While he's there, he must function by the rule and the demands of the government of Nigeria. That's how it works. I'm a Nigerian in Nigeria today. If I violate the governmental requirements, the legislative requirements of this country, I'll be put in jail. Does that stop me from being a Nigerian? No, I am still a Nigerian, but I may not have access to the rights of citizenship because I violate the law. This is how it functions. And there are seven governments that keeps the presence of God. And every believer must function by those seven governments in order to live perpetually under the ambience of God's presence. And I'm not talking about the laws of Moses. I'm talking about the organic government of the presence that every man interacts with the moment he comes into the kingdom. Remember, Jesus said in John chapter 3, verse 3, except a man be born again, he cannot perceive the kingdom, the dominion, the government of God. So I'm talking about an organic reality that takes place when a man is born again in order to carry and to dwell perpetually in God's presence. And I'm saying this because some of these are precursors of hunger, because I'm going to talk a bit about hunger for the presence before I round up the class. So the first government of the presence is the government of light. The moment a man receives the Holy Spirit, that government is activated in the man, the government of light. Ephesians chapter 5 verse 13. You are going to see how that the government of light is one of the government that the Holy Ghost brings a man under. The government of light. Daniel chapter 2 verse 22.
the Bible spoke of God as dwelling in light. He said he revealed the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in darkness, and light dwelleth with him. So when a man is born again, he begins the journey of intimacy. And the first way to enter into that economy is that he must interface with the government of light, because God dwells in light. In 1 Timothy 6:16, he said immortality dwells with him, and he is in the realm of unapproachable light. So if you are not exposed to the government of light, you can never carry the presence of God. What does light do? The first thing the government of light do is that it judges the flesh. It judges the flesh. 1 Corinthians 11:31. The government of light judges the flesh. It says, for if we would judge ourselves, we shall not be judged. How does this judgment take place? It says, we all with unveiled faces. 2 Corinthians 3:18. Beholding as in a glass the image of God. God is light. We are changed. What that light seeks to do is to bring us to a place where we see the standards of God. Because if we don't do it now, he said God will do it. In 1 Corinthians 4:5, the Bible says, judge nothing before its time. For when God shall appear, he shall judge the things of darkness, and he will make manifest the counsels of the heart. Then every man shall receive praise of God. Remember, he said light is that which makes manifest. A man can afford to live the way he pleases because he has not come under the government of light. You may think it's normal to talk the way you want. You may think it's normal to eat the way you want. You may think it's normal to do whatever you want until you come under light. In Isaiah 6:1-5, he said, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. I saw the Lord. He saw the being of light. And the moment that being showed up, something happened. Isaiah began to speak. This was a national prophet. He said, woe unto me, I am a man of unclean lips. So light comes to manifest to you your tendencies. If you don't appear before the light of God, you may never know your tendencies. You may undermine the flesh. You may assume that you are doing well. He said in Romans 1:17, therein is the righteousness of God revealed, the light of the gospel, from faith to faith. So as you journey through this light, something begins to happen. That is when God exposes you to yourself. You now see yourself, and then you realize that, I am callous, I am wicked, I am unmerciful, I talk too much, I eat too much. It is the light of God that reveals it, because when the light of God comes, it unveils the dimensions of God. And when you see God, then you have the need of realignment. The government of God brings light. The government of light brings us to the place where we see and judge ourselves. The second thing the government of light does is that it brings us into the economy of the counsel, the secret, the understanding, and the ways of God. A man can never know the ways of God. A man can never know the counsel of God. A man can never know the wisdom of God. A man can never have the understanding of God until light is shed upon him. He said in Ephesians 1:17, he said, for this cause I pray to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, that he may grant unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, that the eyes of your understanding may be enlightened. The word enlightened is the word photizo. It means to shed light upon your understanding. So you may think you have direction. You may think you know what to do. But he said there is a way that seemeth right unto a man. The end thereof is destruction. So what the light of God does is that it brings you into the economy of the wisdom of God, the understanding of God, the counsel of God, the will of God, the ways of God. So if a man doesn't enter into the presence, if a man doesn't live from the presence, he cannot have that light. This was where Moses lived from. And when Moses showed down, the Bible said he wished not that his face shone. And the Moses that came down was not a man. He said, teach them laws, ordinances, statutes, and precepts. Moses now became the custodian of the oracles of God. The reason is because he dwells in the presence. So when you see a confused man, know that he has a lack of the presence of God. He may be born again, but he doesn't have understanding. He doesn't have counsel. Daniel was in Babylon, a place of treachery.
a place of sorcery, a place of wizardry, yet Daniel had light. How was it possible? Because he was a man of the presence. In Daniel chapter 6, verse 10, the Bible said, as his custom was, three times in the day, he prays facing Jerusalem. And hear the testimony of Daniel. In Daniel chapter 5, verse 11, this was a queen of the hidden kingdom. Speaking about Daniel, there is a man in thy kingdom, in whom is the spirit of the holy gods. And in the days of thy father, light and understanding and wisdom, like the wisdom of the gods, was found in him, whom the king, the Nebuchadnezzar, thy father, the king, I say, thy father, made master of the magicians, astrologers, Chaldeans, and soothsayers. Daniel was in the class with sorcerers, astrologers, enchanters, but because of light, Daniel was 10 times better than them, because they function by darkness. So where their understanding ends, that's where Daniel begins from. And in verse 14, the king will reiterate what he heard, because the testimony was enormous. He said, I have even heard of thee, that the spirit of the gods is in thee, and that light and understanding and excellent wisdom is found in thee. Why? The spirit of the gods is in thee. So it's not enough to have the Holy Spirit. There is a work of light that the Holy Ghost wants to do in you. And if you don't stay in the presence, you will never function by light. This is why many people keep asking, I don't know, when does God want me to go into ministry? I don't know, how does God want me to start ministry? You want to get into ministry with uncertainty? No, you have not interfaced light. When you interface light, God will, you will enter into counsel. You will enter into understanding. The light of God is what brings direction to mortal man. He said, it's not given to man that walketh to order his steps. If you have not seen light, you'll be confused. So two out of many things light does is that, one, light exposes you to yourself, because it reveals God's standards to you. And when it does that, you judge yourself. Secondly, light brings you into the economy of God's counsel, God's wisdom, and God's understanding. This is one of the facilities that proves that a man walks under the presence of God. It is not feeling based, it is reality based. If you walk under the presence, these dimensions will work. You will not function by assumptions. Every step I've taken in life, I took because God told me. I don't take steps because I can do. I take steps because God says to do. And every great man you see in this kingdom will always tell you, and God said. And God said. That's a man that functions by light. He has definite direction. Definite direction. And that's how it works. That is how it works. Men of the presence. The second thing, or the second government of the presence, is the government of sound. Sound basically is a conveyor of spiritual realities. Sound is not volume. In a more quantum sense, sound can be discerned by its frequency. You may hear, there are many sounds that are not audible, but they are still sound. So sound is not reduced to audibility. Sound is actually a frequency transmitter. The ability to convey reality. So there is a government in God's presence that conveys and transmits reality. This is why when a man lives under the government of sound, he is a man who is perpetually quickened. So if there is no quickening in your life, it means you are not under the presence. These are indicators of the presence. If there is no quickening in your life, you are not under the presence. Your circumstances notwithstanding. It was John that said, I was in Patmos for the testimony of God, Revelations 1, 9 and 10. And I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard a voice as of a trumpet. And as I turned, instantly he entered into the presence. So he was in the Spirit. I told you, you are in the Spirit when you have the Holy Spirit. He was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, but something was happening. A governmental dimension of the presence was at work in him. So even though he was in that environment, he was not conscious of the circumstances he was in. He was not conscious of the desolate nature of that environment. He was in the Spirit. He was conscious of God. And the government of sound extended an invitation to him. And he said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. And I heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet. And as I turned, in verse 10, and saying, I am Alpha and Omega, I am the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Suddenly he had entered into a place and God began to bring him into depth and into layers of mysteries and understanding, simply because he was quickened. So sound quickens us because it needs to convey realities. Acts chapter 2 from verse 1 to 4, the Bible said, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, there came unto them a sound as of a rushing mighty wind, and cloven tongues as of fire alighted upon them, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. If there is no government of sound in your life, you will never receive the quickening of God. And what you need in order to succeed in life and destiny will not be there. This is why we hunger for the presence. First, that we may see God and will be judged, because light is perpetually upon us, and that we may function by the counsel of God. Secondly, that we may walk under the government of the sounds of heaven, so that we can constantly be quickened in order to receive the realities that are required to prosecute our destiny. The second thing that sound does is that it brings you into places in Christ. And I tell you, there are many things you cannot do unless you come into places in Christ. It was Prophet Elijah that said, "In before God whom I stand, there shall be no rain or dew." So you don't just command the heavens to go to, you don't just command drought because you are a believer. You command drought because you are standing before the presence. In Ephesians chapter 1 verse 21, the Bible said, "We are seated with Christ in heavenly places, far above principalities and powers." Now, you sit there because you are in the presence. That's why there are two believers. One can contend with demons. One can contend with principalities. The others cannot. Both of them are legally assigned to sit with Christ in heavenly places, but one of them is under the government of sound. So one of them is under the government of sound. And because he's there, he can command things in the natural. So when you see a man rebuking demons, when you see a man regulating things in the territory, changing civilizations, customs, patterns, and traditions, know that that man is standing in the place in the spirit. This is why John could not write to the churches until he was carried and quickened by the sound of heaven. When he entered heaven, he could write down. John had written the Gospel of John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. But when he was writing the book of Revelation, he said, "Any man who reads this book is blessed. Because this one, I brought it from heaven. I entered a place in the spirit." And he began to give direction and perspectives to specific churches. To the angel of the church in Ephesus. To the angel of the church in Philadelphia. To the angel of the church in Laodicea. He was sending specific messages because now he has reality for all of those churches. The reason is because the government of sound quickened him, and the government of sound brought him into places in Christ Jesus. The third thing that you encounter as a man entering or walking in the presence is the government of the fire of God. The government of the fire of God basically purifies. It purifies. So when you see the dimensions of God, the fire is quickened to purify you. This is why Isaiah saw the Lord, and Isaiah began to confess in Isaiah chapter 6 from verse 1 to 6. He said, "Woe unto me, I'm a man of unclean lips." That's the walking of light. So you see God's standard, you compare it with your standard, and you know that, oh, you are nothing that God desires. But that does not bring a change. The change begins when you begin to mingle with the fire. So Isaiah cried in God's presence, "I'm a man of unclean lips," but he didn't stop there. Fire had to come upon him. So in Malachi chapter 3 verse 2 and 3, the Bible said, "God shall appear in his temple as a refiner's fire, and he shall thoroughly purge the sons of Levi, so that they can bring an excellent offering unto the Lord." So the fire purges you. So when light brings you, light will first of all show you what you are and what God expects you to be. And when you accept that verdict of God in the state of brokenness, then the fire of God begins to purge you in order to refine you. So the government of fire purges the believer. The government of fire purifies the believer. And in that purification, there is yet another government, the government of the stones of God. So in that purification, God re-engineers and realigns you. So when Isaiah came before the fire, he said one of the seraphims took a thong and removed one of the stones in the midst of the coals of fire, and it touched my tongue. Instantly, the lying tongue, the tongue that is wood, was realigned. So Isaiah came back to the earth, and for the first time, Isaiah began to give the messianic prophecies. The messianic prophecies are the cardinal prophecies of Isaiah's calling, but he could never prophesy. Does that mean he was not prophesying? No, he was prophesying. He was even a national prophet. But what was in God's heavenly charter for his destiny, he couldn't touch it until his tongue was realigned. And Isaiah came from verse 9. He began to talk about the Messiah. That was the cardinal of his calling. But he needed to be touched with the coals of fire. Those stones, the government of the stones brings realignment. The government of the stones bring establishment. Without the contact with the government of the stones in the midst of the fire, a man will not be aligned. So light brings you counsel and it exposes you to the standard of God so that you can compare with your standard. Sound quickens you so that you can enter into places in God, and then it brings you realities, transmit realities from the realm of God to you. Fire brings you purification, and then the government of stones brings realignment. And then thirdly, you come before the government of the crystals of God. The secrets of God are shrouded in the crystals of God. The reason is because of the way crystals function. You see, when light passes through a glass prism, something happens. One white light passes through a glass prism, what happens is that the light is separated into seven colors. That means the mysteries of God that are coded, that are crypted, can be deciphered when they are viewed through the prisms of God. So the natural thing explains the supernatural thing, according to Romans chapter 1 verse 20. So the natural thing, even the mysteries of the Godhead, can be unveiled by natural things. So the technology of crystals reveal to us how the mysteries of God are shrouded in the spirit. So when God wants a man to understand the mysteries of his realm, he exposes him to his crystals, and suddenly the man can see the specificity of the dimensions of God. Excuse me. The first thing the crystals of God does is that it brings the man to a place of realizing his insufficiencies, because a proud man can never see the mysteries of God. So the crystals, this is why sometimes you go for a meeting and then the power of God moves tremendously, and then the second meeting you go with so much confidence, you don't know you're in the flesh, and then you do the same things you did and nothing happened. So you realize that it is not in the act, it's in the supply of the spirit. You become humble, because the secret things belongs unto God, Deuteronomy 29:29. But the things that are revealed belong to us and to our children. Until it's revealed, you cannot have it. In Psalm 24 verse 14, he said, the secret of God is with them that fear him. He will show them his covenants. So what God does by the technology of the crystal is to let you know that you're in heaven does not mean you will know. John was the one who entered heaven and was weeping. Revelation chapter 5 verse 1 to 5. He said, and I saw in the right hand of him that sat upon the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereon? He said, and no man in heaven, nor on earth, neither under the earth, was found worthy to open the book, neither to loose the seals thereon. And I wept much. So John was in heaven, yet he was weeping for the scarcity of understanding, because mysteries are locked. So the government of the crystals of God humbles a man. You will know that it's not given to man that walketh to order his step. So you will be broken. You would accept that you are but a mortal man, and until you are helped, you are vain. That's what the crystals does. So God can bring you to his realm, yet you live with scarcity of understanding. The crystals of God humbles a man, because the mysteries are locked away. This is what Paul said. He said, I was brought into the fellowship of the mystery to make all men see. So the crystals locks away the mysteries of God. And the second thing the crystals does is that it unveils God when a man is broken. He said in Revelation chapter 4 verse 3, I looked upon him that sat upon the throne, and his likeness was like jasper and sardine stone. So God deliberately hides his dimensions in crystals. So what we see when we enter the heavens of God is not the fullness of God, because God dwells in light unapproachable. But God decides to reveal a measure of himself through the crystals that we see. This is why the high priest is clothed with crystals. The ephod, the 12 stones on the chest of the high priest, carrying different crystals, which are symbolic of different mysteries. And I don't have the time to explain it now. But each of those crystals is symbolic of a particular mystery. And the last of those stones, which is jasper, is a statement of brokenness. Jasper. The last of those stones, which is jasper, is revelatory of brokenness. So the high priest enters with a state, a spirit of brokenness. So each of those crystals is symbolic of a mystery in God. Without mystery, God cannot be known. So God will open up the mysteries of his reality so that we can tap into measures of his understanding. This is what the crystals do. So a man can stand in the midst of light yet be confused, unless he is broken enough for the crystals to open the dimensions of God to him. This is why the Bible said in Psalm 51 verse 17, it said, "For the sacrifices of God are a contrite heart. For a contrite heart and a broken spirit, the Lord cannot despise." The Lord cannot. So God releases himself upon a man that sustains brokenness in the presence. So when you see a man who actually knows the presence, that man is a broken man. It's one of the signatures of the presence. And then the sixth government we come under is the government of the waters of life. Every time we access the government of God, we interact with measures of his spirit. In Ezekiel chapter 47 verse 1 to 5, Ezekiel began to reveal to us, if you see a man who is depressed, if you see a man who is battered, if you see a man who is always complaining, he doesn't know the presence. Because one of the things the presence does is that it brings refreshing. The Bible said times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Father. Times of refreshing comes from the presence of the Father. So Ezekiel revealed to us in Ezekiel 47 verse 1 to 5. He said, "Afterwards he brought me again unto the door of the house, and behold, waters issued from under the threshold of the house eastward." Remember, God comes out from the east. The presence of God comes into the tabernacle from the east, and he is resident in the sides of the north. If you study Ezekiel 44 verse 1 and 2, you are going to see that God comes from the east gate. This is why the east gate in the tabernacle is always locked, because that's where God issues out from. So the waters coming out is the measures of God's presence. It says, "For from the front door of the house stood towards the east, and the waters came from under from the right side of the house unto the south of the altar. And then they brought me out of the way of the gate northward, and led me about the way without under the gate, by the way looketh eastward, and behold, there ran out water on the right side. And when the man that had the line in his hand went forth eastward, he measured 1,000 cubits and brought me through the water, and the waters were to the ankle." He brought me through the water. Again, he measured 1,000 feet and brought me through the water, and the water was to the knee. Again, he measured 1,000 and brought me through the water, and the water was to the loins. And again, he measured 1,000, and it was a river that could not pass over, for the waters were rising, waters to swim in, rivers that could not be passed over. So when you see a man overflown with the rivers of God, the joy of God, the gladness of God, a man who cannot be depressed, know that he's a man of the presence. These are indicators. These governments are indicators. They are parameters that we are actually living in the presence. You see, so you come out with measures of God. Men who don't pursue the presence, they have the scarcity of God. Their soul is always lean. And this is why they tend to other things. They tend to pornography, they tend to arguments, they tend to fight, they tend to wickedness, because there is scarcity in their soul. But there is a river, the Bible said in Psalm 46 verse 4. It said, "There is a river that flows, the streams whereof shall make glad the cities of God, the holy tabernacles of the Most High." So there is a river that maketh glad the cities of God. When a man begins to mingle with the presence, something happens. He receives measures upon measures, measures upon measures. And if those measures don't come, then unfortunately, we are not creatures of the presence. And finally, what happens is that we are brought to the tree of life. The tree of life is simply the rhema word of God that comes to us every time. Carriers of the presence have access to the voice of God. The Bible said in the cool of the day, the voice of God came walking in the garden. Genesis chapter 3 verse 8. The voice of God. The voice of God is always walking in the presence of God. The moment the presence of God comes, the voice of God comes. And in Matthew chapter 4 verse 4, it says, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." In Matthew chapter 6 verse 11, he said, give us this day our daily bread. So eating the tree of life, eating of the tree of life is a daily business. And only men of the present have access to the voice of God to eat of that bread. And if you don't eat of that bread, you will not be strong. In 1 Kings 19 verse 5 to 7, it says Elijah was exhausted, lying down under the juniper tree. And the angel came and said, arise and eat. And then he rose up and he ate. And again, the angel showed up and said, arise and eat, for the journey is great. The journey of destiny is great. And only men of the presence can have a strong finishing. If you don't feed on the bread of life, if you don't feed on the tree of life, if you don't feed on this food continuously, your spirit man will be weak and you cannot finish strong. Finishing strong is a function of how much of the lively word is in your spirit. And the second thing this does is that it establishes you in the courts of God. In Genesis chapter 2 verse 9, we saw how that the tree of life was in the presence, the midst of the garden. In Revelation chapter 2 verse 7b, we saw how that the tree of life is in the center of the courts of God. So a man who perpetually feeds of the tree of life is a man that lives in the midst of the presence of God. Revelation 22 verse 2 and 14, the tree of life in the presence of God. So we need to feed of this tree of life every day. Now, having seen some of the benefits of the presence, that one, it brings us under the government of light, and that light, first of all, reveals God's standards to us so that we can judge ourselves. That light brings us into the economy of God's wisdom, understanding, and counsel. And then we saw the government of sound as the quickening power of God to bring us into realms of realities, and as well to bring us into places in Christ Jesus where we can rule and dominate our world. And then we saw the government of fire that purifies us. We saw the government of the stones that aligns us. So having explained what the presence of God is, and then the seven governments that reveals that the presence of God is perpetually upon the man, I want to show us today the hunger for the presence, how to hunger. Now, you can also say the government of the presence that I revealed are why you need to hunger for the presence. Because one, the government of light, it exposes you to the standards of God so you can judge yourself and have the right evaluation of yourself. And secondly, it brings you into the economy of God's wisdom and understanding and counsel so you have direction in life. And then the government of sound transmits God's reality to your realm. And then it quickens you into the realm of God so you can interface God. Government of the fire purifies you so that you can bring an acceptable offering unto God. So that's your eternal insurance. The government of the stones aligns you so that you can walk on earth consistent with the requirements of God, the will of God, the mind of God, and the desire of God. The government of the crystals brings you access into the mysteries of the kingdom. And it is only by mystery that we have a headway in life. It's only by mysteries that we rule in this realm. And then the government of the waters fill you with measures of God so that you cannot deplete. Like the everlasting God that fainted not, you become a man that does not weary or faint. And then the government of the tree of life enlivens you so that you live perpetually like a God among men and you dwell in the courts of God. So having seen all of these beautiful significances for the presence, you know that hunger for the presence should be a pursuit of life. In my own estimation, a man is blessed when he makes the pursuit of the presence his greatest pursuit in life. A man is blessed when he lives perpetually in God's presence. A man is blessed when the totality of his being and reality is a stream of the realities of the presence of God. That's what I call a blessing. And if that happens, that man will not only have abundance in this life, he will also have abundance in the spirit. And that man can change things on earth, including government and civilization. Now, the question we need to answer very quickly now is, how do we hunger for the presence? So, very quickly, how do you hunger for the presence? The first way to hunger for the presence is actually the first way you were introduced to the presence, which is salvation. What salvation does to you is that it exposes you to the love and benevolence of God. And if you are able to keep that joy of your salvation, you will constantly hunger for the presence. In Psalm 21 verse 1, the Bible speaks of the joy of our salvation. It said, the king shall joy in thy strength, O Lord, and in thy salvation. How greatly shall he rejoice. The king shall joy in thy strength, O Lord, and in thy salvation. How greatly shall he rejoice. In Psalm 51 verse 12, you are going to see that the joy of salvation provokes the hunger for God's presence. And when David lost that joy of salvation, he began to cry for it instantly. He said, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation and uphold me freely by thy spirit. Because if that joy of salvation is lost, you will be amazed that the appetite for God will be shut down. This is why most of us, when we give our hearts to Christ, we were running to church every day. We were so excited about church. We were so excited about the Word of God. We wanted to know everything the day we gave our hearts to Christ. Everything. We wanted to know it that day. It's simply because of the joy that comes with salvation. The joy that comes with salvation provokes a desire for the presence. If a man has a genuine salvation, there will be hunger for the presence. So one of the ways to hunger for the presence of God is to be saved. Is to be saved. In Isaiah chapter 61 verse 10, you see how that Isaiah 61 verse 10, it says, I will greatly rejoice in the Lord, my soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garment of salvation. So a man rejoices, a man presses after God, a man desires God. Why? Because of the salvation he clothed him with. When God brings salvation in man's way, that man cannot but benevolently, lavishly desire the presence of God. So the first way to hunger for the presence of God is by the joy of salvation. The second way to hunger for the presence of God is by keeping the right company. Because one of the ways to deplete and to diffuse appetite for the presence of God is to stay within the wrong company. If you stay with the wrong company, they will diffuse the hunger of God in your spirit. In Proverbs 27 verse 7, the Bible says, iron sharpeneth iron, as a man the countenance of his friend. For me personally, all my friends are pastors. So you wake up today and then suddenly somebody is praying in tongues from morning to evening, and then something is stirred in your spirit. They challenge you, they stir you unto godliness, they push you unto godliness. Because if you don't have men that sharpen you, if you don't have men that stir you, if you don't have men that motivate you, you will be weary. The excitement of God will go down. Most times, the reason we become less excited about God is because we mingle with people who are excited about other things, and they transmit that excitement for other things to us. So, one of the special ways, very important way to keep your hunger for the presence of God is by keeping the right company. In Psalm 122 verse 1, David said, I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of God. I was glad. If you meet a man of hunger, he pulls you to the presence. So that's one way to hunger for the presence of God. You must keep a company that drags you to the presence. But if you mingle with men who do not have it, they will pull you away. In Jude chapter 1 verse 19, the Bible said, these ones are sensual, not having the spirit. They are sensual. What happened? They became men of emotions and flesh. The reason is because they were exposed to people that weakened their desire for the presence of God. So a man wants to hunger for the presence, he wants to know how to hunger for the presence. Stay with those who are on fire for God. Stay with those who hunger for the presence. And not too long, you will discover that that hunger will be stirred up in your spirit. It was Peter and the other fishermen, that encountered Jesus, and suddenly they abandoned their boats, abandoned their net, and followed Jesus from that day for 3.5 years. And then you are like, really? Yes. These guys were professional fishermen, but they encountered somebody that had a hunger for another dimension. Remember Jesus said in John 2:17 that the zeal of my Father's house consumed me. So the moment they encountered Jesus, it became a journey into God. And you notice that after Jesus left them, just before the Holy Ghost came, Peter went back to fishing. So what kept Peter pursuing after God was the man he was working with, Jesus Christ our Lord. The moment Jesus left, Peter went back to fishing. And Jesus came again and said, dovest thou me? He said, Lord, you know I do. John chapter 21. And then when the Holy Ghost came, glory to God, Peter's fire was stirred, and you realize that these guys were always with their own company. When they were called, when they were threatened, when they were flogged, in Acts chapter 4, the Bible said they returned to their own company and they lifted their voice in one accord. If they had gone to another company, they would have run away from Jerusalem and mission would have ended. But they returned to their own company, and their own company did not tell them, oh, if they are dealing with you, it's better we take this thing easy. It's better we hide. No, they lifted their voice in prayers, and the place where they were was shaking. And the Bible said, with great grace, gave power unto the testimony of the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, and great grace was upon them. The reason is because they went to their own company. So they knew how it works. This is why the Bible always admonishes that we should not despise the company of the brethren. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. So we must develop the culture of keeping the right company if we want to stay on fire, if we want to perpetually hunger for God. So how to hunger for God? Keep the right company and you will hunger for God. If you don't keep the right company, you not too long, your hunger for God will go down. So these men showed us the pattern. So Peter kept that company. When he was going to prayer in Acts of the Apostles chapter 3, he went with John and he was going to meet the company of the believers. So if you dissociate yourself, you are vulnerable. The devil can take you up as an easy prey. Ensure to keep a company of men who hunger for God, and you will always keep your hunger for God. There are so many young people today, they only come to church for the religiosity of it. After service, their friends are either gambling somewhere, or they are either doing their makeups, or they are making hair, or they are watching a movie, and that's the company they keep. And they are wondering, why can't I hunger for God? Why can't I stay on fire for God? How can you ever be on fire for God? It's not possible. It's not possible. You are with people that blunt you out. You are not with people that sharpen you. So it's impossible to keep your hunger for God. So you need to consciously and constantly build the right relationship, and then you will discover that hunger for God will be strong. The third thing that provokes hunger for God, or makes you keep your hunger, or how you should keep your hunger, is your realization of your insufficiencies. If you think you are strong in yourself, you may not have need for the presence of God, and you may not go there. If you have not realized that flesh is full of insufficiencies, you may never desire God. It was Isaac that said to Abimelech that my days on earth have been short, but it has been full of affliction. Little wonder you see that not just Isaac, but the whole family sustained the pattern of altars, because they knew that apart from God, they are weak. So Abraham went the way of altars, Isaac the way of altars, Jacob the way of altars. So their sufficiency was constantly on God. You saw that when Jacob was returning from the house of Laban, and he knew he was going to confront Esau, his brother, Jacob told everybody to move aside, and he went to God's presence. In Genesis chapter 32, he went to God's presence. From verse 24 down, he went to God's presence because he knew that there's no way he can contend with Esau. Esau had already sent 400 warriors coming to meet with Jacob. He didn't know if Esau was coming to kill him. So the only assurance he had was the presence of God. Most times we don't go before the presence of God because we still believe in something other than ourselves. Maybe your confidence is in your friend, in your uncle, in your father. If that confidence is what you really anchor your life on, then you will not have need for the presence. But the truth is that any man that puts his confidence in flesh is wood. So our realization of our insufficiencies is one of the great precursors of desiring the presence of God. In Psalm 51, verse 1 and 2, and verse 16 and 17, here was David, after having had an affair with Bathsheba and manipulated the death of his husband Uriah, realized that he was wicked, he was weak, he was mundane, and that God would even take his spirit from him. That David's realization of his insufficiencies made David to go before the Lord and began to plead. That was what led David to the presence of God. And in Psalm 51, verse 17, David will cry out to the Lord that what is the sacrifices of God? It's a contrite heart. And a contrite heart and a broken spirit, the Lord cannot despise. If you have not seen your insufficiencies, you will not desire the presence of God. You must see your insufficiencies to desire the presence of God. In Exodus chapter 5, verse 22, Moses had come to Israel only to realize that Israel had rejected his testimony. So Moses went back to the Lord. He came to Egypt before as a deliverer to take Israel, because he had the rod of God, he had certain signs that proves that he was a deliverer. But the elders of Israel rejected his testimony. And Moses ran back to God. Why would you send me? Lord, why me? Exodus chapter 5, verse 22. The same thing, Exodus chapter 6, verse 12. So every time Moses confronted Pharaoh and Pharaoh rejected his offer, he returned back to the Lord. So a recognition of your insufficiencies will take you to the Lord. But if you can do everything, if you can cut the short, you may never have need for the presence of God. So you want to know how to hunger, always realize and see that in yourself is no value.
only God in you is value and you want more of him. Remember, one of the governments of the presence is that God fills you more and more. If you don't realize that you are insufficient, you will never desire the presence of God. So one of the potent ways to hunger for the presence of God is to always desire, always realize that you are mortal and that only God completes you. The fourth way to hunger for God's presence is to stay under his government. If you detach from government, your fire will go down and it may become difficult for you to desire God's presence. So when you catch a fire, when you catch a hunger, nurture it by staying under God's government. And the way to stay under God's government is by continuously and constantly staying under the dictates of the Spirit of God for your life. I'm not going to go religious by telling you, read so-and-so chapter of the Bible in a day, pray and so-and-so hour. That's a good discipline. But the dictates of the government of the Holy Spirit is the insurance for sustaining your fire in the Spirit. The Holy Ghost is the one that knows what your spirit needs part time. So while the discipline of daily worship, daily prayer, daily study is good, you must be sensitive to the dictates of the Spirit of God streaming from your inside. The Bible said in Leviticus chapter 6 verse 12 that the fire on the altar must not be put out. The priest must put wood on it every morning. So when your spirit is revived and you nurture it, it will be natural for you to desire God's presence. But if you allow that revival goes down, you start struggling with going to the presence of God or seeking the presence of God or living from the realm of God's presence. The reason is because you let the fire go down, and you leave the fire go down when there is no government. And I say government is the continuous and progressive dictates of God's Spirit upon a man's life. So how does the Holy Ghost do it? It keeps popping out movements, keep popping out instructions, keep popping out sensations in your heart, and you're discerning it and aligning to it. It's what quickens you. If you study the scripture, you're going to see a lot of ways the Holy Ghost prompts us. Sometimes the Holy Ghost prompts a man to go and pray. Sometimes the Holy Ghost prompts a man to go to a quiet place. Sometimes the Holy Ghost prompts a man to worship. All of these things will keep you desiring God. But if you allow a disconnect and the fire dies, it becomes a struggle. So how do I hunger for God's presence? By staying under the government of God so that I can retain and preserve the fire of God that I have caught and received from God's presence. The fifth way to keep God's presence is the practice of spiritual realities, or what you call spiritual exercise. If you don't have a culture of spiritual exercise, you will not hunger for the presence of God. You may not even know until it is completely diminished. You may not notice it, because usually, like it's always said, when light is disconnected, it doesn't mean the fan stops rotating instantly. It doesn't mean the iron goes cold, the pressing iron goes cold instantly. It takes a while, just like the fig tree became dry the next day. So if you don't keep a practice of a life of spiritual exercise, you may not know when the presence of God is diminished in your life. The Bible said bodily exercise profits little, but spiritual exercise profits more, for it profits in this life and in the life to come. So every believer must keep constantly practicing certain dimensions of spiritual exercise to keep him desiring and desirous of God. Because if you don't engage the practice of spiritual exercise, something happens. Lust will replace the economy of love. As you practice and engage yourself and exercise yourself in the Spirit, what you do is that you give the Holy Ghost liberty to share the love of God abroad in your heart. And that love of God is what constrains you and causes you to desire God. But if you don't practice, if you don't constantly engage spiritual principles that will keep you on fire for God, that Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost at work in you, would easily, and because of his sensitivity, his restraining force will keep declining in your life. And the point will come when you going to God's presence will become a burden. You stand up to pray at night and for 5 minutes you are already asleep. There is no power in your spirit anymore. Reason, because you have not engaged the Spirit of God in you. How do you practice? How do you exercise yourself in the Spirit? The first way to exercise yourself in the Spirit is by developing a culture of prayer. The life of prayer is one of the ways a man keeps his hunger alive. The Bible said in Daniel chapter 6 verse 10 that as his custom was, he prayed 3 times every day. The Bible said in Acts of the Apostles chapter 10 that at about 12 o'clock, Peter went to the upper room to pray. The Bible said in Acts chapter 3 from verse 1 that at 3 o'clock, they went to the temple to pray at the hour of prayer. So there is a culture of prayer that every believer must imbibe. If you don't have the culture of prayer, not too long, your hunger will die. So the second way to exercise yourself in the Spirit in order to develop the hunger for God's presence is by meditation and contemplation on the word of God. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 4 verse 13 and 15, it said, until I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, and to doctrine. He said, give thyself wholly to these things, that thy profiting may be made manifest unto all. So if a man wants to keep hunger, is by continually feeding on the word of God. That's how you hunger for God's presence. If you want to increase your appetite, all you need to do is to eat more. Even if it's a little more, add more, add more. And before you know it, your appetite becomes so large and you would hardly have enough. So you exercise yourself in studying the word, reading the word, listening to messages, and then meditation on God's word, which is talking the word to yourself and visualizing the word of God. So if you don't do that, you will not know how to hunger for God's presence. You know, these things are supposed to be spontaneous, but they will be spontaneous if we are healthy in the spirit. If a man is not healthy, he will not have appetite for food. And one of the ways to stay healthy is to feed on the word of God. The Bible said, man shall not live by bread alone, Matthew 4 verse 4, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So you want to know how to hunger for God's presence, just stay on his word. But the thing you need to know about studying the word of God, staying on the word of God, is that when that revival begins in your spirit, follow it up. Most times we allow it and then the circumstances of life come to choke that appetite and then we lose it. But if you catch a fire and you begin to nurture it by eating the word of God continually, you would realize that the hunger just keeps growing. He said, my son, in Proverbs 4, 20 to 22, attend to my word, give thine ears to my saying, let them not depart out of thy heart, keep them in the midst of thy heart, for they are life to them that find them. And I told us already, if you are healthy, you'll be hungry. They are life to them that find them. So most times the reason we don't hunger for the presence of God is because we are not alive. We are deadened in the spirit by the anxieties, by the troubles, by the worries of life, by the needs and necessities of life, and it becomes difficult for us to realize that we are creatures of the presence and we're designed to live from the womb of the presence. This is why it's important for us to stay healthy by exercising our spirit through meditation and contemplation. The word meditation is the Hebrew word hagar, and it simply means talking the word to yourself. The word contemplation simply means visualizing the word of God. If you talk the word of God to yourself long enough, you start seeing it play out in your spirit. I'm not talking about those who pick the word to go out and preach. I'm talking about feeding yourself with the word of God until your spirit man becomes strengthened. This is why the Bible said, let the word of God dwell in you richly. So you must have to practice the act of meditation and contemplation. The third way to keep yourself afloat in the spirit and to constantly hunger for God is by being filled with the Holy Spirit, talking to yourself in psalms, in hymns, and in spiritual song, making melody in your heart to the Lord, singing the Spirit, chanting the Spirit, worship God with songs and with praise, and something happens. That praise will constantly launch you into God's presence. In Psalm 100 verse 1 to 4, the Bible tells us how that it is through praise, through worship, that we come into the house of God and into his courts. So you want to know how to hunger for God? Keep your spirit afloat with chants, with hymns, with melodies, and with spiritual songs in your heart. And you'll see that you are always overflooded with a desire to stay in God's presence. Many don't have these practices. The reason I'm taking time to just share it in the basic way, the way I am doing, is because practice is what sustains it. I can release the energy of God and then your heart is set on fire. But if the practice dimension is not handled well, the fire will just be there for 2-3 days, and then before you know it, you are back to status quo, and the hunger of God will die in your spirit. So you need to constantly practice by prevailing prayers, by meditation and contemplation, and by constantly feeding yourself with the word of God and with chants, with hymns, with melodies in your heart continually. Finally, the way to keep hunger for God or to hunger for God's presence is by the act of waiting, the conscious practice of the act of waiting upon the Lord. God is a king spirit, and we must make every effort to bring ourselves to that point where our soul becomes quiet and we focus on the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul said, if you say you are dead in Christ, in Colossians chapter 3 verse 1 to 3, let your affection be on the things that are from above, where Christ is, for our life is hid in Christ and Christ in God. So Paul is saying that one of the proofs that we are actually everything Jesus has paid for is when we are continually desirous of God. And the way to achieve this is by putting your affection on God. How do you quieten your soul and bring your soul to focus on Jesus Christ? That is what waiting is all about. Waiting is not a state of quietness or closure of the eyes and trying to keep a state of tranquility externally.
Waiting is actually a state of inner tranquility where your soul is focused on Jesus Christ. And that, again, beautifully, you can achieve by praying through, by worshiping, by meditation and contemplation. And you would realize that you are having a smooth ride in God's presence. Every one of us must become a creature of the presence. This is why you and I were designed. We were designed to mingle with God so much that our lives become conduits through which the dimensions of God, who is locked in the Spirit, is manifested in our world. This was the life that Jesus, the pattern man, came to reveal to us. He said, God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophet, has in this last day spoken unto us by his Son, who being the brightness of his glory, the express image of his person, upholding all things by the word of his power. Philip was the one who asked Jesus, show us the Father and we will believe. And Jesus said, you mean you've been with me and you still ask me of the Father? Whoever have seen me have seen the Father. That means Jesus was a continuous overflow of the dimensions of God, of the life of God, of the power of God, of the glory of God. He dwelt in the presence. And this is the culture of Jesus Christ. If you look at the life of Jesus, you are going to see consistent fellowship with the people of God. You are going to see consistent prayer. You are going to see consistent study and meditation on the word of God. The Bible said in Luke chapter 6 verse 16 that he went into the temple to read as his custom was. So Jesus this was the life of Jesus Christ. And every believer who wants to be a man of the presence, walking under the dominion of God and conferring the same dominion to his word, must become a man of the presence. And these practices must become your lifestyle. Remember, spirits respond to consistency because power dwells with consistency. If you will practice these things and not just approach it religiously or emotionally, you would realize that your life will become an endless stream of the multifaceted dimensions of God. And that is where your life will have meaning, because you are brought into this realm to stream the life and the light of God, who dwells in light unapproachable. You become the theater through which God can be seen visibly. You are the God that your world sees. But how much of God do you carry? That is what will determine the dimension of God that the world can see and know. You must become a carrier of the presence. Today, my prayer for us is that the Lord will stir up hunger in our spirit. I pray that the fire of God that ignites the spirit of man will come upon somebody listening to me today, and that the energy of God will overwhelm somebody today, and that hunger that is in our spirits, because we are born in the image and the likeness of Christ, will rise up and overwhelm us, and will become creatures of the presence, living perpetually in the presence and reflecting the same. I release grace upon somebody today to seek the presence of God. I make somebody today, by the anointing of God's Spirit, a seeker of the presence. I decree that life begins to amplify itself by the protocol of light and understanding in the womb of somebody's spirit today. I ask that the wombs of your spirit be enlarged, so that women who can groan in the spirit to beg dimensions will be born. I decree today that your life move forward in the direction of God's presence. Every force that have countered you, every force through loss, through oppression, through condemnation, that has kept you away from the presence, in the name of Jesus Christ, I decree that those forces are shattered. And right now, come alive in the spirit. I call forth the dimensions of God that are locked up in your spirit, waiting to find expression, to begin to flow like a river. Let it flow like a river in the name of Jesus Christ. As you go into your word, may your eyes glow with the eyes of God. May your hand flow with the life of God. And may your utterances become an effulgence of the nature, the power, and the glory of God. I declare that everyone listening to me today will not just be a carrier of the presence, but will become an agent of dominion that will bring the kingdom to your sphere of influence. Your country will come under the presence of God because you are there. And every one of us that is supposed to contribute our quota to the quorum in the spirit, to bring down the glory of God and to make up for the territorial ranking that is required for the overflow of the glory of God, you will be part of it, and you will be nominated by the election and the politics of heaven, so that the abilities of God will make you a distinctive capacity bearer in your generation. In the name of Jesus Christ, I thank you, Father, because these words are established and perfected in Jesus' name. Thank you so much, Pastor Ariam Bashan, for having me. It's such a great honor. And until I come your way again, may the Lord bless you richly. It's such a great honor to be part of the B Project. and I believe that somebody's life has just been shifted. I tell you the truth, in Christ Jesus, many of you will come into corridors of encounter and you will receive greater ability to seek after God's presence. The encounter that begs hunger in the spirit of a man is released upon you. I didn't preach about that because that will come upon you by impartation. And I declare that women will rise in the order of Deborah. I declare that judges will rise from among you. Princes in the spirit will rise. Elders, wise men, cunning artificials, judges, men of order and rank in the spirit, men of stature that can move the hand of God and shape territories and alter negative civilizations for good, will rise from among you in the name of Jesus Christ. I release grace, I release virtue upon you, and I know that your life will never remain the same again. You will be a voice in your generation, and darkness will recognize that truly you are an ambassador of the kingdom, because the kingdom is upon your shoulder and you will bring it to your world in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you so much, man. It's such a great honor. I look forward to our next session, and I believe it's going to be power-packed, because that session will come with life and power, and it will be full of impartations as the Spirit of God will enable. God bless you.